Everyone, thank you for coming back to us. I'm Rainey, she's Rita, and together we are the Underbelly.
Yay!
Yay.
One day we will
go. We follow pop culture, or the dirty underside of pop culture, so you don't have to. That's our tagline, right? We do it so they don't have to.
Exactly.
God damn, we perform exactly. A public service.
But sometimes, I mean, you know, sometimes we do encourage you to do it, because sometimes we cover things that are actually pretty good.
Like today! Finally, we're getting classy. Oh my God. My mom will be so proud of us. She always does ask, why can't you girls do something nice?
For once, God damn it.
Or cover something that you like. That was her complaint about Taylor Swift. No, actually, oh my God, I can't believe I didn't tell this to you. My mom wanted to know, if you don't like this girl, why do you listen to her?
Oh, Rainey's mom, I wish I had an answer.
I was like, I don't know, Mom, because what else will we do?
She's everywhere. I mean, she's just hard to...
Not in my mom's world. She actually wasn't sure if Taylor Swift was a boy or a girl, because she thinks Taylor's a boy's name.
Well,
so in the wonderful mommy verse my mother lives in, Taylor Swift is not ubiquitous.
I was looking for that word and I couldn't think of it. I was like, what's that word where it's everywhere? Yeah, thank you very much.
That is why I teach college. Okay, all right. Before we begin, please follow us on YouTube and SoundCloud, where we are the Underbelly Podcast. You can email us at podcastunderbelly@gmail.com and Outlook. Plus, you can look at us up on our Twitter handles, GirlInTheMoon7 for Rita and @RaineyScribbles for me. Please comment. We love to hear from you guys. Tell us maybe what other positive things we can cover so my poor mom doesn't have to listen to us for 2 hours rage about someone we don't like. Or tell us what you think about our subject for today, which is, drumroll please, Rita.
Jane Austen's Pride and Prejudice.
Fucking Pride and Prejudice, because we're classy, damn it.
That's for sure. We have our moments anyway.
And, you know, this is something I'm so proud about, because we are both huge book lovers, and this is actually something that I am using my college degree for. Yay!
Yeah. What's funny about this is I don't think I actually in school ever had to read Pride and Prejudice, but I read it probably before I could really even totally understand it. So it was wasted on me, and then read it again later and obviously loved it the more and more I read it and the older I got and read it. I remember in college I had to read simultaneously. It was like the same semester. For one class I had to read Emma.
Mm-hmm.
And for, oh my God, my romanticism course, I had to read Mansfield Park. And it was funny because when I signed up for romanticism, I didn't understand what romanticism was until I signed up for the class. And I was like, oh, that's what that is. And then I was also taking British literature, and that's where I was reading Emma. So, of course, I already knew the story of Emma. I don't think I had read the book yet, but I knew the story from the Gwyneth Paltrow version. And then I read Mansfield Park, and I fucking hated it.
I was so mad in my British romantics class. My professor wouldn't let us read Jane Austen because he felt that she was trite and overwrought.
Wow, I'm furious with him right now.
So we read a whole bunch of, you know, the Bronte sisters, right? We read Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. And, of course.
Sorry, go ahead.
And we also read a lot of Thomas Hardy.
For my romanticism course, we read a lot of poetry, Wordsworth, Shelley.
Oh, God. Rime of the Ancient Mariner.
Oh, fuck's sake. And I remember reading, and it was just kind of weird. We were reading Mansfield Park, and I had this, like, you know, older professor, and I went in, and he literally would just read to us the entire time. And it was really, you know, a very long class. And I remember, you know, it's always surprising, I think, especially for people who like English, you know, who enjoy English classes, when you get to college and you realize that there's just some classes and there's just some topics that you are just not going to be about. And, you know, I could appreciate it. And some of the poetry I liked, some of the stuff I liked. But I remember Mansfield Park, I was like, Jane, you fucking dropped the ball here.
I do remember reading Jane Austen for my British intellectual history class. And, oh, my God, I literally want to punch myself in the face whenever I say I took a British intellectual history class. And I just got so mad that we spent such...
She sounds Californian.
That I want to punch myself in the face?
No, it's like British intellectual class. I don't know.
It's like, of course you would. Of course you would. Yeah, but my professor just spent like 2 days on Jane Austen, and the rest of the time we focused on the Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood.
Yeah, I don't really get why she's so overlooked. Like, even now, I feel like people, you know, you can see it sometimes in romantic comedies or, I mean, I think even just, like, in everyday when you bring up Jane Austen, people are like, oh, you know, she wrote, like you know, an older version of Chick Lit, essentially. But that's not true at all. Her stories are so complex.
Which leads us perfectly to Jane Austen, right? I mean, here we are talking about our bygone years of college. Well, no, you're still a baby. It's not too sad that you talk about college yet. Because that makes me sad. But Jane Austen, right? Okay. As we know, British author.
So my baby, my love, Jane, she was born, her birthday's coming up, actually, December 16th, 1775, and she died on July 18th, 1817. She's known for her 6 major novels, Sense and Sensibility, Pride and Prejudice, Mansfield Park, Emma.
Which you love, Mansfield Park.
I do. And Northanger Abbey and Persuasion. I actually love all of her novels except for Mansfield Park. I'd say that's the one I hate, and then my least favorite is Sense and Sensibility, and then I love the others, of course.
Persuasion actually is my favorite. Well, for the longest time, Pride and Prejudice was, but I find as I get older, I actually really love Persuasion. Now,
which was her last novel. It was actually published after her death, which I think is actually pretty interesting, and it was written while she was very ill. So it's interesting to see her. She died at 41, to see her sort of reflect back on life, and I think that's certainly a tone you can find in Persuasion, that longing and like missed opportunities, and so it's pretty interesting. But she was a pretty interesting person. She was very sassy. Luckily, a lot of her letters that she wrote during her life have been preserved, so we get to see her personality. She was a kind of judgmental bitch, but I love her for that.
I think of her more as, like, she's someone that I would chill with in the corner while she makes sarcastic observations about people.
Yeah, she was like, I feel like, the quintessential people watcher. And I think she had very established ideas of what was appropriate or what was right or whatever. And she's very funny in representing that in her books. She represents in her books, you can see in your own life, even in 2017, almost 2018. So, She's just a really interesting person. She uses irony. It's probably her most prevalent literary element used. She is just so super ironic and sarcastic and sassy and witty, and I just absolutely love her, and I think that she's brilliant. That's just me, though. She was, you know, we refer to it as Georgian-era literature.
Well, I think she straddles in between Georgian and Regency because of her lifespan, right? Like, born in the later Georgian, and then more Regency, I would think. But as you pointed out, she was forced to dedicate a book to King George.
Yep. Yes. And she was not a fan of him, and neither were many at the time. And I just think it's really interesting that she did it, but, like, it's really funny because her books constantly poke fun at the stiffy upper crust of society. She even, like, you know, even Emma, where her, we'll get into this later, her protagonist is this rich, spoiled brat.
And that's the book that she was forced to dedicate.
Right, yes. Even Emma, I mean, she's like this rich, you know, this girl from a really great family and all this other stuff. Like, she really plays with that whole concept, which I think is great. So the books are about the landed gentry. She writes a lot about the wealthy. There's nobody, I think the only poor character she ever writes about is Fanny from Mansfield Park.
Harriet Smith from Emma.
Yeah, I'm thinking of the protagonists, though, like the main characters. Pride and Prejudice, you see, okay, this is where it gets a little difficult, because Elizabeth, our main character, is not rich, but she is a gentleman's daughter, as she likes to point out later on in the novel, and it's valid, right? She's, even though she's poor, she comes from good stock, if you will. Same for Sense and Sensibility. They come from, the girl, the sisters come from good stock. They don't have money, they're scrambling. And then, of course, the men that they get themselves involved with do come from good stock and are ridiculously wealthy. So,
but that's also what's so great about her books is that it kind of turns the head of the ideas at this time that, you know, these women were so sheltered, they're proper ladies. No, these women know about finances, they know about inheritance laws. Yes, they want to get married. But it's not always, oh, I want to marry someone to fall in love.
Well, it also challenges the idea of men at that time as well, of what a respectable man looked like, and what a prospect of marriage looked like, and what a man should be, and, you know, all those different things. You know, you could have a man like Darcy, we'll get that. He has all the check boxes of a perfect match, and yet he needs to mature throughout the novel to be a decent person.
Exactly.
And she makes that distinction that it's not just enough to have a good name, and it's not just enough to have a lot of money. You need to be a decent person to back that up. And it's really interesting that she goes into that. But there is a, and I always think this is interesting, there is a criticism that some people feel of her work, that she never really veers very far from the gentry.
Well, she is someone who's writing about what she knows.
Okay, but not everybody writes. You know what I'm saying? I think it's interesting that a lot of people point that out, and I think it is true that it's like she writes about these women who all have, and we'll get into later, but kind of all have happy endings, right? Like, they all, like, manage to find themselves into these great situations with a lot of money. And it's never really about anything other than that. They're always women who are, like, really... And you know what? Even when they're poor, like I was saying before, they don't really suffer too much because of their name.
Oh, yeah.
Which Austen, I think, went through in her life as well.
Well, I don't know. I think Fanny totally suffers because she marries that wet rag of her cousin.
Fucking Fanny. Don't bring up Fanny to me until next. So this time we're talking about Pride and Prejudice. Next time we're going to talk about Jane Austen. And I think overall, right? That's what we're going to do?
Yeah.
I fucking hate Fanny.
I don't know. Maybe we'll just make it a three-parter and talk about how much we hate Mansfield Park.
Holy shit, I hated Mansfield Park. I remember reading it and being like, what the fuck is this? Like, there's not even one thing to grab onto in that book for me. And yeah, you're right. He is a wet blanket. He's just useless.
So, other than us totally being total Jane Austen fans, why are we doing this? Well, because Pride and Prejudice is one of the most well-known books, I think, there exists in Western culture. It has been done so many times, as we brought up earlier. Bridget Jones's Diary is basically Pride and Prejudice. The Meg Ryan, Tom Hanks movie, You've Got Mail. Yes, I know, before anyone else points out in the comments that it is a remake of a previous book called Shop Around the Corner, but the premise is Pride and Prejudice, and it's even brought out in the movie with Meg Ryan and Tom Hanks. It's Meg Ryan's favorite book. They read passages to each other, which, goddamn, Rita, that is woman porn right there. A man who will read Pride and Prejudice to me.
Yeah. I'll settle for a guy who will watch the BBC version with me.
All 100 hours of it.
Did you ever see Lost in Austenland?
I saw a little bit of it, but the main character just made me irritated when she, flashed her cooch.
There's a book and there's the movie with Carrie Russell of Felicity fame, and she's in the internet. What is it, The Russians, whatever the hell that show is now that I don't watch.
Oh, no, I'm thinking of a different book then. Then it's not Lost in Austenland. It's another book, it's another movie. It's a British movie about this girl who goes into her Jane Austen Pride and Prejudice novel, and she redoes it. She ends up with Darcy.
Yeah, I know that one. Oh my god, what is that called?
I don't know. Tell us what it is in the comments. Help us out. Tell us how we're dumb because we don't know. How dare we call ourselves Austen fans? And
I don't stop it. No, I liked that one. You didn't like that?
She just bugged me.
I liked the guy. The guy who plays Rickon is funny.
You know what? I gave up. I don't even know if I got into the guy who plays Wickham. I'll give it another shot. How about that? By the time we do our part two of this, I'll give that movie another shot.
Sure. Whatever you need to do.
Whatever I need to do to get caught up, right?
Talking about Carrie Russell is Austenland. Okay, so those are the two separate things. Lost in Austen was the miniseries. Austenland was the movie with Carrie Russell.
Okay. So, the most famous line, right? The most famous line in Austen's bibliography is from Pride and Prejudice. And Rita, do you want the honors?
Yes, please. It is a truth universally acknowledged that a single man in possession of a good fortune must be in want of a wife.
And it's been used a lot in almost every single adaptation from Pride and Prejudice, which is the Bollywood version. They talk about that. It's been used in even the 1940s version of it.
The Mormon version?
Yes, even a play of it has been used in Pride and Prejudice and Zombies, which, did you watch that?
Parts of it.
I actually read the book and the sequel, Dawn of the Dreadfuls.
Oh, there's a sequel. Oh, Rainey, honey.
And hey, even people who haven't read the book or saw any movie would realize the names, would recognize them, right? Elizabeth, Lizzie Bennet, Mr. Darcy.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that you were absolutely correct when you said Jane Austen is considered, you know, the precursor to chick lit, because the plot of Pride and Prejudice is basically the basis of every single chick movie there is. Boy meets girl, girl doesn't like boy, boy doesn't like girl, witty banter back and forth.
Yeah. And then, the quintessential movie.
Yeah, exactly. And Rita, do you want to recap for our listeners what exactly happens in Pride and Prejudice?
Okay. Charles Bingley, the very wealthy young gentleman, rents the manor of Netherfield Park in Longbourn, which causes a stir in the Bennet household. So the Bennets have 5 unmarried daughters, Jane, Elizabeth, Mary, Kitty, and Lydia. And Mrs. Bennet is desperate to see them all married. Very important because it's all women at that time, right? And women cannot inherit the land, cannot inherit the wealth. It's important to get them married off. After Mr. Bennet pays a social visit to Mr. Bingley, the Bennets attend a ball at which Mr. Bingley is present. He is taken with Jane and spends much of the evening dancing with her. His close friend, Mr. Darcy, is less pleased with the evening and haughtily refuses to dance with Elizabeth, which makes everyone view him as arrogant and obnoxious. She also overhears him say that she's not handsome enough to tempt him, which is fucked up. So unfortunately,
how dare you, sir?
Fortunately or unfortunately for us, apparently Longbourn is very small, it's a small world after all, and they are constantly thrown together in weird social situations. Over time, Mr. Darcy finds himself increasingly attracted to Elizabeth's charm and intelligence. She's very funny, she's a lot like Jane Austen herself. She's very sassy, she's very critical, but she's also very right with a lot of the things that she says. Jane's courtship with Mr. Bingley continues to grow, and Jane ends up visiting the Bingley mansion. When she's there, she catches ill, she gets sick, and she's in the presence of the 2 sisters, Louisa and Caroline, who are very snooty and bitchy.
Especially Caroline.
Especially Caroline. And we find out Caroline is especially bitchy because she's got a huge monster crush on Mr. Darcy, and
James, she's got a hard on for Darcy. Let's be honest. She's got a hard on for him.
Totally. So Elizabeth and Jane are very close. So when she finds out that Jane is sick, Elizabeth literally walks over there, which is at this time a faux pas. Your carriage was your symbol of wealth and status, and that she would dare walk through the countryside, which is like totally unreal for them to see. So she comes over, she spends time with them, she nurses her sister back to health, and all during this time, this is when Mr. Darcy is like hardcore paying attention to her, can't stop looking at her, can't stop engaging in conversation with her, even though he knows that she's way beneath him, at least in his eyes. Eventually they get, you know, they go home. Mr. Collins, their cousin, who will inherit the land because he is the next, you know, the nearest male relative. The mother is pushing them to marry him.
One of the daughters to marry. Hopefully Lizzie.
Right, especially Lizzie, because the mother is overconfident that Jane will be receiving a proposal of marriage from Charles. Rainey, do you want to pick it up from there?
Lizzie, of course, cannot stand Mr. Collins because he is just gross, just completely fawning and gross. Surprise, surprise, Charles Bingley abruptly cuts off contact with Jane and goes back to London.
Wait, so was this the original form of ghosting?
I think so.
Was this the Regency / Jordanian form of ghosting?
At the same time.
Guy rent.
Goes back to London.
Guy rents manor. Flirts with girl at ball. Goes back to London.
Just at this time, coincidence or not, a new regiment of soldiers appear in the village, and one of them happens to be the devilishly handsome Mr. Wickham, who Darcy knows, right? And you know what it is, a guy in uniform turns a girl's head.
Especially, and it's important to note, Mrs. Bennett's and our dearest Lydia.
Yes. Our dearest Lydia, the youngest of the Bennett sisters, loves soldiers. Mm-hmm. And
the mother's favorite.
Yes.
And Bennett's favorite daughter.
And Wickham agrees with Lizzie that Mr. Darcy just totally sucks. And tells her how Darcy, even though he has all of this money, cheated him from his inheritance. And this just confirms everything Lizzie has about Darcy.
Right. And he's so charming and good-looking, and he's the total opposite of Darcy. Like, he's super friendly, he's chatty, and let's be real. Have we always, you know, when we hate someone and we meet someone who's, like, fun to be around and we gel with and they hate the same person?
Oh, like me and you. Our hatred for Taylor Swift bonds us even closer.
Exactly. But am I Mr. Wickham in this scenario, or are you?
Can we both be Mr. Wickham?
I mean, Mr. Wickham is kind of hot. Yeah, but I wanted to point out that I think it's funny that, like, they just start bitching on Darcy immediately.
If you ever read these passages, I read it as, like, Wickham is being Lizzie's sassy gay friend.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. I was just going to say that. I can see it, too. Totally. Like, honestly, and I just know, you know, this is jumping ahead a little ahead, but just in case I forget, I think it's funny that for all of Elizabeth's intelligence and perception and all that stuff, that she didn't think it was weird that he was shitting on this guy immediately. hardcore. Like literally every conversation they had, they were talking about Darcy.
Oh my god, don't you hate him? Oh yeah, and like how he walks too.
You should have at least figured out, like, okay, either something is wrong or he's in love with him, because this is weird. Everything is going back to Darcy. and he was supposed to be what? A vicar? What the hell was he supposed to be?
Well, he had hoped to be, but now that's why he's a soldier. And again, Lizzie doesn't go, wow, weird career change, huh? So only a vicar or a soldier, nothing in between.
Right.
But anyway, a little while later, Darcy comes back with a proposal to Lizzie. And it is, like, the shittiest proposal ever. He basically tells her, yeah, I know that, you know, your family's kind of poor compared to mine, and your mom's a harpy, and your dad is, like, a total non-interested person, and your sister, especially your youngest sister, Lydia, is a slut. But I decided to overlook all of that and ask you to marry me. Don't you feel like Cinderella?
Totally. Are you kidding me?
And I just...
That's what every girl wants to hear. Wait, can I read part of it?
Sure.
So we can totally understand how messed up this is. In vain have I struggled. It will not do. My feelings will not be repressed. You must allow me to tell you how ardently I admire and love you. Elizabeth's astonishment was beyond expression. She stared, colored, doubted, and was silent. This he considered sufficient encouragement, and the avowal of all that he felt and had long felt for her immediately followed. He spoke well, but there were feelings besides those of the heart to be detailed, and he was not more eloquent on the subject of tenderness than of pride. His sense of her inferiority, of it being a degradation, of the family obstacles which judgment had always opposed to inclination were dwelt on with a warmth which seemed due to the consequence he was wounding, but was very unlikely to recommend his suit. Degradation.
Yes, all of my ancestors are being degraded because I am asking you to marry me. Don't you feel like the luckiest girl in the world?
Yeah.
Then, totally. Surprise, surprise, it turns out that Mr. Darcy and Elizabeth Bennet were totally wrong about each other. The only reason why Darcy seems so cold and standoffish is because he's really awkward. Turns out Mr. Wickham was the bad guy. He runs off with Lydia. And Mr. Darcy intervenes because Wickham had tried to do something similar to Darcy's younger sister, Georgiana.
Just read the book.
Everything's undone and put to right because of a letter. There's a double wedding between Jane and Charles Bingley and Lizzie and Fitzwilliam Darcy. It ends happily ever after because everything is fixed by a marriage. I know I'm making it sound really trite, but the writing, the characters are so damn good.
Isn't it kind of interesting? Because it's like almost Shakespearean to a certain extent.
Oh, yeah.
You know how Shakespeare comedies end with a marriage. That's literally what Austen does, which is funny considering the fact that she was a spinster.
Well, I mean, if you watch the Anne Hathaway version, she did have that secret love.
Oh my god. Listen, what is it about you and drawing out the catty side of me? I can't stand Anne Hathaway. I don't know why you'd bring her up. I can't stand her.
You didn't even like that movie?
First of all, I watched parts of it. And I don't like super fictionalized versions of history. So I won't watch them. So I knew that it was. I know about, she accepted a marriage proposal. She literally accepted a marriage proposal. The next morning, went back to the guy and said, never mind.
That sounds like me, though.
So that's what Jane Austen did. So when I knew about the movie, and I was just like, listen, it was like way too romanticized and fictionalized. And I just can't get into that. I hated Anne Hathaway, so it was just an additional thing for me that I was like, I can't watch it.
Well, let's go back to women that you actually love. Elizabeth Bennet.
You know how picky I am, sorry.
I know, and that's why I love you. But Elizabeth Bennet, right, Lizzie, is held up as the perfect female protagonist because she's not perfect. She is snarky. She's sarcastic.
She's not nice to people, like, just to be nice to them. Like, to Caroline Bingley, for example, who's constantly mean to Elizabeth and always trying to provoke her and being really snotty, Elizabeth is always polite, but she never gives Caroline what she wants. She doesn't suck up to her.
Yes. She's not perfect, but she is just so real, you know? She gets irritated with her mother, she has jealousies a little bit, but she tries her best to overcome them. But what about the other women in the book, right? Is she even the most interesting? She might be the most sympathetic character, but is she the most interesting?
Right. Well, then we get to Lydia, who could potentially be the most interesting character, depending on how you read into it. So she's the youngest Bennet sister, as you said before. She's 15 when the novel begins. And there's a point in the novel where a character, you know, is kind of astonished and scandalized that Lydia is, in quotation marks, out in society because she's rather young for it. She should probably still be at home, not out, like, at social functions. But she is, and she's spoiled. She's the mother's favorite. She's frivolous. She's headstrong. Her main activity in life is socializing, especially flirting with the officers of the militia. She loves to dance. That's all she ever wants to do. She's constantly laughing in the novel. And eventually she runs off with George Wickham, who we've talked about before, who is the villain of the story, if you will. Although he has no intention of marrying her. This is so scandalous, and it's incredibly scandalous and daring of Austen to include this in her story. Lydia shows no regard for the moral code of her society. She's not ashamed of what happens. She is eventually made semi-legitimate thanks to Darcy hunting her down and forcing Wickham to marry her, and she still thinks that she's better than all of her other unmarried sisters because she's married now. She doesn't realize that what she's done is looked down on in society. She doesn't really seem to care either, which is very interesting. She's very energetic, she's flirtatious, social, confident, self-assured. On the other hand, she is immature, selfish, silly, impulsive, loud. She's often described as loud, shallow, vain. But on the other hand, is she really what she appears to be? If you read this from a surface level, she seems like she's silly and she's empty-headed, and she's the complete opposite of Lizzie and Jane, her older sisters who seem to have sense and reason.
That she now looks upon, now that she looks down upon when she comes back home, because she's like, oh no, I'm now, you know, I should lead first because I'm married. You girls, because at this time her sisters are still unmarried, you walk behind me.
And is there any wonder that there's that mentality in the family, because the mother constantly talks about them getting married. Like, that's literally all they have to aspire to, is to get married. And now Lydia, her favorite, has gotten married, and it doesn't matter how scandalous or how horrible the situation is or how stressed her mother was during the time when they didn't know where she was and she wasn't married yet. All that matters now is she's married, and because of that, she's better than them.
Exactly. Great parenting there, Mrs. Bennet. Great parenting.
And I like how you point out how she, there's an argument to be made that she drives the novel, that she's really the one who starts the plot.
She does. And
that's really interesting.
She does. I can't say that I took credit for it, because I did find it in an article, and I'll link to the original article in the comments. But one thing that I think a lot of people overlook, and I know I overlooked it despite the numerous times I read Pride and Prejudice, is that Lydia's the one who gets everything going. The mom is trying to think of, oh, well, how can we, you know, me and your father, convince these guys to invite us to a party to get to know them better? And Lydia just comes out and says, when you throw your first party, you must invite us. And that's it. That's all she needed to do.
Yeah. I don't know. I think that Lydia is a lot more important than meets the eye.
And in a way, isn't she more of a liberated woman? Because she sees a guy that she likes, right? Mm-hmm. Wickham. She goes after him. And she doesn't care what his social standing is. She doesn't care, you know, is this a proper match? And she doesn't even care about getting married in the birth order, which was the, you know, which was the unspoken code at the time, that the oldest sister marries first, and then you go down in birth order. It's actually quite shocking that she marries before Jane and Lizzie and Mary and Kitty. That's, you know, that's very unusual, and she doesn't give a fuck.
If you consider the time, and then you consider how they got together, mm-hmm. and then you think about the 50s, 60s, 70s, in some places of the country and in some families even today, being the youngest, being like 15, mm-hmm. running off with some guy who has no prospects, who has no real occupation, who has no real money, mm-hmm. hanging out with them unmarried. I mean, it's crazy now and during those decades I mentioned, imagine then.
Yeah. So I think in a way, you know, Lydia is really this liberated woman. She's more of a modern woman than Elizabeth is. And yet, for some reason, we kind of sympathize more with the with the criticisms about her. Like, oh, she's so loud. She doesn't know her place. She, you know, doesn't wait her turn to speak.
I agree with everything you're saying. However,
you still dislike her as much as ever?
What?
You still dislike her as much as ever?
I think that she's a ridiculous character. I think that she's a plot device. And I think that it's interesting to look at it from that point of view. But we're looking at it that you, the original source that you sent me that is looking at it through modern eyes, right?
Yeah.
I think that she is ridiculous, and I think that if we try to give her any sort of depth, then that takes away from Austen's message. I think that she's representative of her mother, of their mother. Lydia is entering a relationship that mirrors semi-closely to the relationship of her parents. It is not going to be a happy marriage. She's someone who does not think about the others. She's someone who does not consider society. And I think that Austen, and I think that Lizzie, has a respect for society and manners and rules. As stuffy as they may be, there's a respect there for them that Lydia does not have. And I think that Austen I don't even think that Austen feels any sympathy for her. She doesn't paint her as a very sympathetic character. I think that's why readers don't initially think of her as that. And so I think to kind of give her
a certain depth,
much depth, undercuts Austen's point about her. But I don't know, I could be wrong.
No, I mean, it is an interesting way to look at her, because I've never viewed her like that. And I think there is something to be said that Lydia starts the novel, right? And then she also starts the third act of the novel, where Darcy and Lizzie realize they had made these assumptions about each other. If Lydia had not...
If she didn't run off with Wickham, none of this would have happened.
Exactly.
Elizabeth would never have ended up with Darcy. They needed that to drive it along.
Exactly. 100%. So another female that I think is also interesting, right, and has always fascinated me, is the young Miss Darcy, Georgiana Darcy. Am I pronouncing her name right?
Yeah, Georgiana.
Because I'm never sure. Is it Georgina or Georgiana? That I...
Georgiana.
Okay. Mr. Darcy's younger sister.
I've watched
sister.
The TV version and the movie. All of a sudden, too much to this point.
See, I'm never
really sad.
Because I read the book first, right? So I read it as Georgina, but then in the BBC version, they said Georgiana, so I'm not sure if it's like, is it just the British pronunciation, you know, like schedule and schedule? So I'm never sure.
I read the book first too. Before I even knew about BBC. I didn't even know that I remember finding, and I'm always sad that I found that out a lot later than I could have. I could have been, you know, enjoying Colin Firth for a lot longer. But I think I thought the same thing as you, that it was Georgina.
Exactly, right? Right. Let's pronounce it like calling it colonials and say Georgina. No, it's Georgiana. Okay. Now, I have something to ask you before we move on. Don't you think it's strange that Wickham is always hanging around 15-year-old girls?
Yep.
Okay, right. I'm just like, Amber alert.
It could be a couple of things. I mean, especially hanging out with a girl that age who has that much money. They're impressionable, and he's very charming, and he's described as very good-looking, and they're the easiest to dupe. I mean, Lizzie's 20 and he's duping her pretty well as well, so.
Yeah.
If he gets himself in with a 15, 16 year old who has money, but you know what, Lydia does not have money and he knows that, so there is that to be said too, that it's an interesting point.
Well,
I thought about that myself too. I'm kind of always like, why is he hanging out with all these young girls? I mean, I think that he gets off on his own ability to manipulate people, but it is an interesting thing for sure.
Well, okay, so going off track, but please indulge me on this, right? It's the same thing. Well, you and I are both teachers, and I don't know about you, but at the end of the day, I don't want to hang around and make small talk with my students. Don't get me wrong. I love my students. I love my job. Believe me, no one goes into teaching because you think that's where all the money is. You do it because you like to teach. So I don't understand these teachers who have affairs with students.
Yeah, I don't understand that at all. I don't look at my students and think anything other than this child, but I'm, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I think about it a lot. I think about it, and I know this probably sounds messed up, but I really especially don't understand the female teacher with the male student.
Okay, well, see, this brings me perfectly to Wickham and his thing for 15-year-old girls. All right, so I find that grown men have interests other than their relationship. Because they've got other shit happening, right? No one has time to, like, sit there and listen to your bullshit except a teenager. So Wickham hangs around with teenagers because they will sit and listen to your bullshit and they won't challenge you. And Lizzie, even though she is attracted to Wickham, is like, nope, this isn't going to work out. You don't have any money. You need to marry a rich woman. I'm going to get kicked out of my home when my father dies. I need to marry someone who has prospects. This isn't going to work.
Yeah.
And like Lydia.
But you know, again, I mean, you know, maybe we're getting ahead of ourselves, but it is a question I want to ask and I don't want to forget. Mm-hmm. Why do you think he trifles with Lydia?
I think that he hangs out with Lydia and thought that he could mess around with her and her father couldn't force him to marry her. Like, he was going to run off with her, have some fun, and then, you know, just send her back home.
Do you think it was to get back at Lizzie?
No, I don't think so.
He sees him. Remember, she serves him tea, and he tries to do his typical thing where he's like, oh, Darcy, what a loser, right? And she's kind of like, not. At this point now, she realizes that Darcy is actually the good guy and Wickham is the bad guy, and she doesn't come out and directly say it, but she says something, and Wickham, for all of his flaws, is smart.
He's very intuitive.
Very smart. Mm-hmm. And he realizes there, you know, Austen describes in that scene that there's an understanding between them now. Like, he gets now that she sees him for who he is. So I've often wondered why he would put himself in that position, right, where he could have had any girl. It's interesting that he picked Lydia. Lydia is described as very attractive. She's described as very voluptuous and, like, again, I point out laughing a lot, like that giddy girl. So yeah. There's all those reasons too, but I often wonder, was it something to get back Lizzie with? You know what I mean?
Exactly. And this perfectly dovetails to Georgiana, because the reason why Wickham and Darcy have that animosity is because, we hinted at this, Wickham had convinced Miss Darcy, Georgiana, to elope with him, but their marriage is stopped by Darcy, right? And now that Lizzie tells Wickham, basically, hey, I'm on to you, I'm now on Team Darcy, it would be almost a perfect revenge if we are to believe that Wickham is that evil. That, you know, okay, you're taking Darcy's side. Now I'm going to do to your sister, your 15-year-old sister, the same thing that I was going to do to Darcy's 15-year-old sister by ruining her, because Miss Darcy would have been, according to society's rules, ruined, shamed, even if she had eloped with Wickham, the fact that she had run off.
Right.
So it would...
I think he was a spiteful little dick. And I think that in another life,
mm-hmm.
I think he was very interested in Lizzie.
I think so too.
I think he was attracted to her. I think he was attracted to her actually probably more than he was to Lydia.
Or Georgiana.
And I don't know if you remember this, but in the novel as well, when she's kind of going through the country with her aunt and uncle.
Mm-hmm.
And it's before she has that infamous meeting with Darcy at his estate. She sees where at Pemberley. She sees what Pemberley looks like when she starts softening towards him.
Uh huh.
And it's after she's received the letter though. She's already kind of, you know, he says in the letter that Wickham is bad, and she kind of is starting to believe it. And she finds out a rumor that he's courting or pursuing another girl. And it's funny because nothing happened to them directly. Like, he doesn't know that Darcy proposed to her. He doesn't know that Darcy gave her a letter telling her all about him yet. But she hears that he's been pursuing someone else.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, I still think that he was interested in her. And I think that actually it's really interesting. If you read their back and forth dialogue.
Mm-hmm.
It's very charged, very, like, sexually charged, I think.
Oh, yeah.
It's very flirtatious, it's very quick, it's very fast, and it's very much the opposite of the back and forth she has with Darcy. Now, that isn't to say that the back and forth that she has with Darcy is not erotic. It is, for sure, 100%, but in a very different way. There's, like, more depth to it, whereas with Wickham, it's like that. Like, it's obvious. Like, people around her are noticing it.
No, I totally think so, too. Like, the thing with her and Wickham, I think it's more of, like, a sexual attraction.
Yeah.
But
I think that there are a lot alike in some ways. I think that Austen deliberately puts characters in her books to sort of indicate where a character, like how characters are alike and how they could end up like it, like in Emma,
mm-hmm.
Which we'll get to next time, I know, but Emma is very much like, could have turned into the wife of Elton, for example. Lydia sort of fulfills her future as her mother. She's exactly like her mom.
And she and Wickham are going to be so miserable together.
Oh, my God. Poor. You almost feel sorry for Wickham, don't you? Almost. Just desserts is exactly correct. So I always think that Austen puts in these characters to show how characters could be if they don't mature and grow. Mm-hmm. If they don't have a little humility and adapt to whatever's happened. I think she does that on purpose. And I think that there's a side of Lizzie, mm-hmm. that's like Wickham. And I don't mean, obviously, that she's trying to lure, like, 15 and 16-year-olds.
But how intuitive they are. Like, how intuitive they are, how good they are at reading people, and exactly. How good they are at, you know, adapting to a situation.
And being very social and likable. Like, people really liked Wickham.
Yeah, and when Darcy insulted Lizzie, everyone turned on him for insulting her.
They were like, fuck him.
Fuck you, dude.
Not handsome enough to tempt me.
Okay, which makes me ask, right? Do you think that Miss Darcy, Georgiana Darcy, is really as innocent as she's portrayed by her sister and everyone else? Because, you know, Lydia
Lydia ran off with Wickham without being married, and God knows what those two did together before they were finally caught, right? Mm-hmm. Before Wickham was forced to marry her. Do you think Georgiana is not quite as sweet as innocent as her brother makes her out to be?
You mean like a virgin?
Or was she so... Was she like the innocent victim of Wickham's charm?
I think she was an innocent victim.
You don't think she was another Lydia?
No. I actually think she's the opposite. I think she's like Darcy. I think they're both very shy and it manifests differently due to age and gender and all that jazz. And I think that she was very shy, and I think that, you know, their parents are dead.
Mm-hmm.
Darcy is her guardian.
Mm-hmm.
But he's very busy. He's a gentleman. He's got a lot of responsibilities. He's got to be a lot of different places. And she was probably very alone. And then enters Wickham, who's a family friend, who's known Darcy for years. And at this point, Darcy doesn't really have any reason to not be friends with him.
Mm-hmm.
And she loves Darcy, right? Georgiana worships him and looks up to him. So anybody that's okay in his book is okay in hers. And she's probably lonely, and she's got the attractive and very social and very charismatic Wickham with her. And I think he made her believe he loved her because he wanted her money. And I think it was probably very easy for her to buy into that. Well, I really do think she's as innocent as she is portrayed. I really do think she is. Do you remember the scene? There's a scene, right? You know, obviously after, it's much later in the book, Darcy's in love with Elizabeth. He's considering asking her to marry him again.
Mm-hmm.
They invite her and her aunt and uncle over, and Georgiana's there, Charles Bingley is there, Caroline and Louisa, his sisters, are there. And after the dinner, because, you know, Caroline is such a bitch and she's so threatened by Elizabeth, she starts like talking about her and saying all these bad things about her. And Georgiana, because Darcy has told her, you know, one-to-one that he likes Elizabeth and respects her and all these good things about her, won't say anything.
Mm-hmm.
He respects her brother's opinion so much.
Because that is true. My only thing was Caroline Bingley really likes Georgiana. So I'm like, I don't know, man. Maybe Georgiana might have a dark side.
But because Darcy really likes, I mean, Darcy loves his sister. Whatever he speaks about her, like, those are his, even even as a reader, right, if you know nothing about the story and you start reading, and even now, you know, when I reread the beginning, I'm like, Darcy, you're such an ass. And you see him being so, you know, unlikable. And you're like, Jesus Christ, you know, like, just smile and stop being such a dick. And you know, you're thinking all these negative things about him. Even when he talks about Georgiana, then he gets soft.
That is true.
He loves his sister. He has done everything for his sister. And I think Caroline knew that. And she thought that was a way to tap into him. Like, let me show a lot of interest in his sister and pretend that I'm as interested and as invested in her as he is. And then he's going to love me because of that. And, you know, obviously that backfires for her.
This is true, because one thing that gets Darcy to reevaluate his first initial impression of Lizzie is Lizzie going to Bingley's home to take care of Jane. And right. He admires Lizzie's devotion to Jane, and he compares
it to... And how her eyes were brightened by the exercise.
Besides her brightened eyes, is his devotion also to Georgiana. What's wrong with me?
He sees that.
What's wrong with me? Here I am giving Lydia depth and me questioning Georgiana's virtue. Why don't you stop me when I say these things?
Well, because it's more interesting. I agree. I mean, Lydia, there's something really there. Georgiana, I mean, I think you could make the argument. I do think she was legitimately innocent, though. I really do. And I think that she was just lucky enough to have Darcy in her life to step in and be like, whoa, like, you know, step back, Wickham. Otherwise, she would have been lost, too. He never would have married her. Or he would have married her. He definitely would have married her, excuse me. He definitely would have married Georgiana and have just wasted all of her money in weeks, probably.
Okay.
He's a gambler, he's a drinker, all those horrible things, especially at that time.
Okay.
All the debts he's probably accrued.
Okay, so here's a character we totally, totally love, and who you and I think does not get enough fan attention. Fucking Charlotte Lucas. Oh my god, can we start talking about her? Please, I have been dying to talk about this the whole time. This is how sad I am that this will make up, totally make my night. Oh my god, I am so fascinated about Charlotte Lucas, you have no idea.
Tell us why.
She marries Mr. Collins, even though she agrees with Lizzie that he's disgusting, he is a suck-up, the way he just, quotes everything Lady Catherine de Bourgh says.
Why does she do it?
Because she is a spinster. She's on the shelf, she's 27 years old, and still is unmarried. Oh my god, Rita, kill me now. Kill me now, 27 is on the shelf. She has become a burden to her family, right?
A burden to her family. I think it's really interesting, in the 2005 version, Keira Knightley, Emma Thompson wrote the speech that Charlotte delivers to Elizabeth.
Mm-hmm.
She writes the scene, actually, and I think that's interesting that it's Emma Thompson. And Charlotte Lucas, in spite of the fact of marrying Mr. Carl Collins, which is not an attractive
he's an idiot.
One could argue that she's the most feminist character. And I have here something that she says. So she has this back and forth with Lizzie in the movie in 2005.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
In the scene. But I think it's interesting. And they have this back and forth, and, you know,
Lizzie's all like, why? Why?
Yeah, and also just like, you know, he's ridiculous. And Charlotte's like, not all of us can afford to be romantic, which is very close to something she says in the novel. I've been offered a comfortable home and protection. There's a lot to be thankful for. I'm 27 years old. I have no money and no prospects. I'm already a burden to my parents, and I'm frightened. So don't you judge me. And can we argue maybe that she is the most feminist character? Because, yeah, she marries Collins. There's a scene in the novel when Lizzie finally visits her, right? Mm-hmm. And they're sitting there and they're talking, and she doesn't come out and say it, but she's, you know, she knows, Charlotte's very smart as well and very funny, and they have a very nice relationship. And she, so much, you know, she doesn't come out completely and say it, but she knows that Lizzie knows that he's ridiculous. And she sort of tells her that he spends a lot of his time visiting Lady Catherine de Bourgh, doing all of his other responsibilities. And so a lot of the time she's able to sit in her little parlor and be by herself, and she loves it. And she's, doesn't have to worry about being, you know, starving or being a burden to her parents. She's protected here. And for her, that's all she wants. She's not a romantic person. She doesn't need to be in love with whoever she's with.
I read this piece by The New Yorker that I sent to you that I found so fascinating that Austen never puts any judgment on Charlotte for making this decision, that she is in a very similar situation that Lizzie is in, that she is the only child her parents have, her older parents, like Lizzie. So inheritance law at this time doesn't allow her to live in the home that she grew up. She is far...
Point out.
Yes.
She's a fucking... She's always like that... I don't know why Charles Bingley danced with that plain Charlotte Lucas. She's such a bitch.
Yeah. Charlotte doesn't even have any quote-unquote social grace, that she's not a good dancer the way the Bennet sisters are.
Really talented. But, mm-hmm. like Elizabeth, she's very good at reading people, and she's the first person and the only character for us as a reader mm-hmm. who continuously points out that Darcy seems to be interested in Elizabeth.
Yes.
Also, she says something really interesting. You know, Charles Bingley and Jane are, you know, courting each other, and they are at a couple of functions with each other, and she's having this conversation with Lizzie about them. They're talking about them, and Elizabeth's like, yeah, I think that she likes them a lot. And then Charlotte's like, okay, well, you know, she should act like she likes him even more than that. And Elizabeth's like, what are you talking about? And she's like, she should give him no doubt of how she feels about him to further along so that he'll ask her to marry him and that they're married. And Elizabeth's like, but she doesn't know him well enough for that yet. And Charlotte says, that doesn't matter. Who cares? Happiness is purely chance in marriage. She needs to, like, secure him now. He is a catch. She's very rational. She's very, like, logical about it, right? There's not a lot of emotion there. She's like, she needs to secure him and get him right now.
And I think that also speaks to the situation Charlotte Lucas is in, you know? Like, she's like, hey, man, you know?
She sees it's an awesome opportunity, so she's pushing it. And she says, you know, Jane's not, you know, she needs to be showing a lot more emotion than she does right now. And Elizabeth's like, oh, that's just her way, just because, you know, that's her sister. She knows how Jane is. However, to the outside, she doesn't look interested, and that's why Darcy separates them, because he doesn't think that Jane's interested in him, because he doesn't know Jane as well as Elizabeth does. And Charlotte, in this instance, was 100% correct. She should have, you know, been a little bit more open with her feelings, so that there would have been no doubt of how she felt about him. She was absolutely 100% correct about that. And then there's multiple scenes in the book where she's kind of like, Darcy's looking at you a bit, Elizabeth, and oh, he's visiting my cottage. Well, he wouldn't do that if you were in here, Elizabeth. Like, all those things. She is definitely kind of the wise friend who sees through everything, and she definitely feels like Darcy's into her, and Elizabeth's always like, no, she's not.
I think also she's one of the few people who calls Lizzie out on her bullshit as well. Like, wow, you know, for someone who's really not interested in him, you pay a lot of attention to what he's doing.
One of my favorite things is when they are at the infamous ball, mm-hmm. where Darcy finally asks Elizabeth to dance, and Elizabeth can't refuse him. She can't think of a good enough excuse. Mm-hmm. fast enough, so she says yes, and there's a couple of minutes before she has to dance with him, and she's like, fuck, why did I say yes? And Charlotte's like, think about what you're doing, Lizzie. You know, you'd be a simpleton indeed if you were to just slight him just because of what Wickham says. Wickham is not a man of consequence. Darcy is a man of consequence. He has a good name. He's from a good family with lineage, you know, good lineage. He's the landlord. He's responsible. All these things. Who is Wickham to Darcy? Why are you going to believe Wickham's word over Darcy? Essentially, is what she's saying. And you know, even if you think that Wickham is correct, Darcy is still a man of consequence. He's someone that should be respected.
Yeah, you know, she's basically telling her friend, like, don't fuck things up for you and your family. This guy can make your life hell if you do this. Yeah, you know, like, Wickham's encouraging you to, you know.
And I think that's part of it. And I also think she's kind of just like, you know, Lizzie, for all of her intelligence, it's funny, she is very emotional. So she's really like, I don't want to be with Darcy. That's kind of like her knee-jerk thing. I don't want to dance with him. Why couldn't I think of an excuse? Because she's going back to that initial time where he's like, she's not handsome
enough to tend to me.
Yeah.
And which we agree is fucked up.
She's like, get over it. He's a very important man. Wickham is not an important man. So no matter how you feel about it, you should show respect to him and think about what you're doing. Like, give him the chance and think about, you know, the fact that he is a person to be respected, that in that time he's someone who should be respected. And Lizzie really should have listened to her.
Yeah,
because Charlotte was 100% correct.
correct.
And then her whole thing, too, is, like, don't you think it's really interesting that the only one who says, like, shitty things about Darcy is this guy over here? Like, and if Darcy does have a reputation for double dealing, how come he's the only one who, you know, speaks of it?
So do you think, I have a question for you, then.
Mm.
Mary's Collins asked Lizzie to marry him, and, you know, she turned him down because uh-huh. he's a hot mess. We know he's obnoxious, he's annoying, he's dumb, all of those things, right?
Yeah.
He's vain, he's superior, all these things. And Charlotte decides to marry him because she knows that he's going to provide money and comfort and all that jazz.
Yeah.
Do you think we should judge? Austen doesn't seem to judge her for it, should we?
Okay. I don't know if I judge her, but I super feel sorry for her. I totally pity her.
That's actually what I wanted to ask. Do you feel sorry? Should we feel sorry for her? Do you think she'd want us to feel sorry for her?
Well, I know for a fact that Austen doesn't want us to feel sorry for her, because in the book, when, you know, they're visiting Charlotte Lucas and Mr. Collins, well, Charlotte Collins now, and Collins is showing his closet and his shelves for whatever reason. I'm sorry. I just find that funny. I'm inviting people to my home. Like, look at my closet that has shelves in them.
Imagine an ex being like, hey, Rainey, come over. Let me show you my beautiful shelves. Like, what on earth? I would, like, call the nearest mental institution and get you checked in because, but he's so, that's the thing, right? Like, Catherine Lady de Begue, his
patroness,
whatever, has come in and done all these home improvements, if you will, for where he's living. She's mm-hmm. patronized him.
Mm-hmm.
And so to him, that's the only thing of value. How sad is that? Scene where Charlotte and Elizabeth are finally alone with each other. And Charlotte's kind of like saying in so many words, don't feel sorry for me. I'm not a romantic person. All I cared about was
my future.
Taken care of.
And then she also says, despite his faults, he is not a bad man because he has agreed that he will take care of her parents.
Right.
So, you know, I mean, she is true. Like, okay, he is not a great guy, but he's not Wickham either. You know, like, Wickham might be handsome and charming, but I do not think Wickham would take care of Mr. Bennet.
Then I have another question for you.
Yeah.
Was Elizabeth unfair in her assessment of him?
I think that Charlotte Lucas is able to see beyond Collins's faults for a man that, you know, she could tolerate to marry. Lizzie, though, knows that if she had married someone like Collins, she would die inside. Because he would not tolerate the type of person that she is. He would, like, stifle her character, her loves, her passions. Charlotte Lucas knows how to... Oh, this sounds so terrible. But Charlotte knows how to manipulate Collins, right? To say, like, you know, dearest, why don't you go visit Lady Catherine again?
Yeah. Why don't you go out into the garden? All those things. She's figured it out, you know. She's admirable. I think that Charlotte's a pretty cool character. And I think she would be an awesome friend to have.
Charlotte has a very high bullshit tolerance, whereas Lizzie doesn't.
Well, like, Charlotte listens to Elizabeth is a cool character, right?
Mm.
But she's also kind of sanctimonious to a certain extent.
Like, and I said, Charlotte has a very high bullshit tolerance.
Right. And she has to listen to her all the time. And I feel like I would turn to Lizzie after a while and be like, shut up. stop overanalyzing it. But, you know, I have to say, as a romantic, mm-hmm. I do feel sorry for Charlotte.
I do, because I think she could marry someone so much better. But at the same time, when and you pointed this out in our notes back and forth to each other, that Charlotte's like, hey, don't feel sorry for me. I know how to get him out of the house. I can handle him.
Right.
I have everything that I wanted. I live in a much nicer home. I have, you know, I married for security.
Her prospects are looking a lot better than Elizabeth's at that time.
Yes. And also, she was really, really worried about her parents, too, because, as we both mentioned, she's in the same boat as Lizzie, that she's not going to inherit anything, and when her father dies, her mother's going to be kicked out, and she would have to, and you know, Charlotte doesn't want to be a governess. She's a gentleman's daughter. What is she going to do? Get a job? And even if she got a job as a governess, it wouldn't be enough to take care of her mother in the style her mother grew up expecting.
And becoming a governess was such a step down.
Yes. You know, that was like, I don't know what's the equivalent to it these days.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, I would even say it's like even lower than the New York City nanny who takes your kid to the park. I mean, it was like such a, because you know what it was? Mm-hmm. It was usually a woman
mm-hmm.
who had been born into a good family.
Yeah.
And couldn't get married.
Exactly.
Either due to, like, you know, some sort of family disgrace or looks, essentially, if you were free or not. And so if you became a governess, it was like your last ditch effort. And I think that's why it was looked down upon so much, which is sad.
And I'm, in a way,
I don't think that Charlotte would have been a good governess either. I think that she actually ended up in the right path for her.
And now she and Lizzie can be neighbors.
Right. For Catherine de Bourgh.
I feel really bad. Caroline Bingley? Oh, before we talk about Caroline, I feel so bad that I forgot about Lady Anne de Bourgh.
It's very easy to forget about her.
Or Lady Catherine de Bourgh. I just, oh God, why did we leave them out? But yeah, I always feel bad for Lady Anne because, you know, she thought that she was going to marry Darcy as well. Like, the only person that was, like, in the way of Caroline Bingley marrying Darcy was, like, Lady Anne de Bourgh. And what kind of illness did Lady Anne have? Like, tuberculosis or something?
She was just very weak and sickly.
I always thought she had tuberculosis. Are you sure she didn't have... she didn't have tuberculosis?
No. I mean, I don't think so.
Why do I want to give her tuberculosis?
Perhaps. I don't know. Let's Google that. But she's described very sickly. So
and pale.
Is Darcy's very wealthy aunt.
Mm-hmm.
And she's a bit of a yenta. And she looks down on Elizabeth. She looks down on everyone. And her daughter is Lady Anne. And in Catherine de Bourgh's mind, Anne and Darcy will be marrying. And toward the end of the novel, there is a very infamous standoff between Catherine de Bourgh and Elizabeth because this is actually very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Because word gets to Catherine de Bourgh that Darcy is considering asking Elizabeth to marry him. She doesn't know about, there's a first proposal, that first proposal I described, we were talking about before, that was very shitty, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know, they've gotten to know one another, they're really seeming to get along. It seems like Darcy's really, you know, into her and potentially could ask her to marry him. And so Catherine de Bourgh shows up in all of her glory at the Bennet's home and demands to talk to Elizabeth and is like, promise me you're not going to marry him and all this shit. And Elizabeth, being her, you know, herself, won't. And she's like, fuck you. First of all, because she's into him, but second of all, because she won't be told what to do by this stuffy, stodgy bitch. But it's very interesting because it's never said in the book how Catherine de Bourgh hears of this. And so it's this big controversial thing. A lot of people have a lot of different theories, but it's never stated in the book how Catherine de Bourgh hears about Darcy's interest in Elizabeth. And a lot of people think Charlotte Lucas is responsible. That Charlotte has hit.
Yeah.
Tipped her off to it.
I think so too. But,
Charlotte said something to Collins about it, and then he said something to Lady Catherine.
This
is very important, because as much as it's true that if Lydia didn't get married, or didn't run off, with Wickham, if Catherine de Bourgh didn't confront Elizabeth, Darcy would have never proposed to her.
You know, it's very interesting. It's
He visits with Bingley
mm-hmm.
at the end, when he finally gives his approval to Bingley, and Bingley finally realizes he doesn't really need Darcy's approval. He visits with him to the Bennets, right?
Yeah.
Says nothing to Elizabeth. Doesn't even look at Elizabeth. Bingley hangs out with Caroline. Not Caroline. Oh my God. Hangs out with Jane. Asks mm-hmm. her to marry him. She says yes. It's all fabulous. Darcy doesn't even think about looking at Elizabeth. Then Catherine de Bourgh shows up, right?
Mm-hmm.
They have their standoff. Catherine de Bourgh is like, tell me that you're not going to marry my nephew, that you have no interest in him. And Elizabeth's like, I don't have to tell you shit.
Which I love that she says that. I love that she says that.
That, right, like a couple days later, Charles and Darcy show back up to visit Jane, which is totally normal. Nobody thinks anything about it. However, Darcy's staring at Elizabeth, and this is when they go on a walk, and he finally proposes to her, and he tells her that he feels like he can propose to her because Lady Catherine de Bourgh was scandalized because of what Elizabeth said, went straight to Darcy, told him all about it, thinking that this was going to turn him off. And instead, he was like, listen, if she's not going to tell this woman 100% she's not going to marry me, then there's some chance.
Yeah.
Which I love. I love that whole dynamic, that whole thing at the end. I love that whole thing.
But someone who we don't love, though, someone that we really don't like, but I find absolutely fascinating.
Caroline.
Caroline, oh my God, she is like all of my mean girl dreams come true. I do. I find her fascinating. Like, imagine how she's like, okay, the only person that I have to worry about is this Anne de Bourgh bitch who is probably dying of tuberculosis. And, you know, Darcy's not going to marry her because of her health. You know, why would Darcy marry a woman who's, like, too frail to even give him children, right? I have an inside track because my brother is his best friend. So I'm going to marry Darcy, and my brother's going to marry Georgiana. And then, like, out of nowhere, Elizabeth Bennet comes and, like, upends everything.
Can I play a song for Caroline?
Sure, yes, please.
You ready?
Okay.
Caroline. You see Caroline, all the guys would say she's mighty fine.
Mighty fine.
But mighty fine only got you somewhere half the time. And the other half either got you cussed out or coming up short. Yeah, and I dig this now even though.
There was like a whole intro to it, so I started playing it and it was like acting out a whole scene. I'm like, whoa, where's the song? something very interesting about Caroline and Caroline, Louisa, and Charles.
Yes, the Bingley siblings,
right? They're wealthy, however, because of their parents, and their parents are wealthy because of their work in trade, their father's work in trade, which is something that was very much looked down upon. You were worthy and cool in that time if you were rich because your family had been rich for centuries. Like, that was what, you know, marked you as cool in society.
This was marked you as a lady or a gentleman.
Right. And your money, heaven forbid, by work, you were looked down upon. Maybe you had become nouveau rich, right? But you were still looked down upon. And so Caroline, Louisa, and Charles are now super, super wealthy. But they have that sort of, Charles not so much because he's easygoing, but Caroline and Louisa certainly seem to have a certain level of self-hatred.
Oh, like cheap side?
Like in picking on Elizabeth and Jane because they're like, oh, you know, their relatives in Cheapside and all this shit. Meanwhile, they made their money via trade. Elizabeth, Jane are daughters of a gentleman.
They
the month like they do, but they have more social standing than they do.
She's just so bitchy.
She is. What's interesting, however, about Caroline is as bitchy as she is, she warns Elizabeth about Wickham.
Yes.
How do we feel about, she approaches her about Wickham. She realizes, everybody realizes that Elizabeth is into him and is paying him attention. And she kind of confronts Elizabeth in a very, of course, passive-aggressive way. But she does say something to her like, what are you doing? I mean, he sucks, you know. Darcy and Wickham had a falling out. Nobody really knows why, but Darcy's amazing, and so something must be wrong, and Elizabeth is too blinded by her prejudice.
Good one.
Thank you. To see, or to even, like, consider, right? Elizabeth, her biggest fault is that she never considers the other side. She's too prejudiced by everything.
Ooh, really, even better one.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm here all night. That's why I get the big bucks. Yeah, me and my literary elements over here. She's too prejudiced to see the different sides of things, I guess, is what I'm trying to say.
This is true, but one thing I can point out by Caroline insulting Wickham, it more or less pushed Lizzie closer to Wickham.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So I can't help but think, I mean, Caroline has to know that Lizzie hated her at that point. So by saying, like, ew, Wickham sucks, I can't help but think that she must have known that that would just make Lizzie even more against Darcy.
I don't know. I'm torn. I think reading it, I agreed with you. I thought that the BBC adaptation. And of course, obviously, this is an adaptation, so there's a lot of leeway with it, but I thought that the portrayal of it was like she's actually genuinely trying to. I think that this is the thing. Caroline legitimately worships Darcy. She thinks he's perfect. She thinks he's a perfect specimen of man and gentleman and all this shit, right? And I think that as much as she hates Elizabeth and views her as a threat, at the same time, I think she can't fathom that Elizabeth would think anything but positive things about Darcy. So in her eternal quest to portray Darcy as amazing and to defend Darcy, I think that she was legitimately being like, you should be on guard with Wickham, only because in her mind she's defending Darcy.
Wickham's a dick. Everybody knows it, Lizzie.
Hey, Rainey.
Rainey. Yeah?
He's not Wickham, he's Dickum.
You did not say that. You did not say that.
If I am not the only person who's made that joke, oh my god.
I've never heard anyone make that joke before.
Oh my god, listen, if anybody ever says Dickum instead of Wickum,
high five them.
Not even high five them. Let me know.
Mm-hmm.
I will be furious. It's my brilliance. I'm just kidding.
You should copyright that.
I never thought about that until right now because he's a dick.
But,
he's a dickum who likes to dickum. Get it? Especially Lydia.
But, do you think that we should feel sorry for Caroline? Like, she thinks she is the perfect woman because she's everything that society says a woman should be, right?
I feel sorry for her because I think she felt like Darcy was a sure thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then she tried, this book takes course over about a year, I believe, right?
Yeah.
Spends this whole year, none of it works. And Darcy, and I brought this up to you before because I think it's interesting. Darcy kind of plays with her a little bit. I think that he's aware of her crush on him. And
even somebody as like awkward as Darcy has to know that Caroline was into him.
From some of the quotes from the novel, I think it's pretty clear that he's aware that she's interested in at least his money.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, he plays around with her a little bit, which is very, very funny. If you read into it like that, it is really kind of amusing. And so she's very much like about him, right? And he does play with her. And I think for her at the end to realize, and there's a scene in the novel, mm-hmm, where I was referring to it before, where she's dissing Elizabeth behind her back with her sister Louisa in the presence of Georgiana. And Georgiana doesn't know what the hell to do because her brother said that Elizabeth is amazing. So that's her thought. She's amazing. So she can't even join this conversation. And she's not a vicious, mean person either. So she can't really even gel with that either. And Caroline goads Darcy, right? She's like, you know, hey, remember when we first came here and we found out that everybody said Elizabeth was supposed to be some sort of beauty? Hey, you remember that? How funny was that? Remember what you said that night? You said you'd soonest call our mother a witch. Do you remember that? Which is like so offensive now that he genuinely loves Elizabeth. And that now, not only is she saying, hey, you thought she was hideous at one time and thought it was crazy that people called her a beauty, but you also said that you'd rather say that her mom, who's this
idiot,
shit, nervous idiot, is a genius. You'd rather say she's a genius than say Elizabeth is attractive. Hey, remember when you said that?
Remember when you said she wasn't pretty enough to tempt you?
Right. He, like, low-key gentleman status like roasts her. And he's like, yeah, I do remember saying that, actually. But it's been many months now since I'd say she's one of the handsomest women of my acquaintance. And Caroline shut the fuck up. And then, at the very end of the novel, after, right, Darcy and Elizabeth have married, there's a line that Austen includes, which I think is very funny, where she says that, you know, now Caroline is very, very super pleasant to Elizabeth. Caroline is still unmarried at the time, at the end of the novel. And now she's very, very kind and pleasant to Elizabeth. And Austen alludes to the reason that, you know, that Caroline still wants an invitation to Pemberley.
Yeah. And I can't help but feel bad for her.
I feel bad for her. I feel bad for her because, and we've talked a little bit about it before too, that she's sort of like a product of the time.
Yeah, I mean, she thinks, I have turned myself into the most perfect woman. Damn it. Why doesn't anyone want to be with me? Why am I unmarried? And Louisa's husband is totally useless. You know she's going to end up married to some kind of moron like that.
So, in typical Austen style, mm-hmm. we have a bunch of couples who are very happily matched.
Mm-hmm.
They're fully in love. They seem super perfect. And then it seems like there's, for every couple that's very happy, there's a couple who's miserable and sad and shallow and vain and whatever. And it seems like that's the case here. It's kind of like the equivalent to all of your friends getting engaged and posting all these really happy pictures on Facebook. You like eating a pint of ice cream on a Friday night. Like it's kind of like that's like Caroline right now.
She's probably like in her home, looking at herself in the mirror, like, why didn't he pick me? Why didn't he pick me? I'm the perfect woman. Why didn't he pick me? Why her, not me? You know, like, imagine that.
I thought it was interesting in the notes you had asked if she justified in how she treats Lizzie. And I wrote to play devil's advocate. Lizzie is quite sure in her opinions, which could rub people the wrong way. And we find out that a lot of the opinions that she has for the majority of the novel are incorrect.
Yeah.
So is she justified in kind of being a bitch to Lizzie?
Well, okay. To go along with you, right? She sees Lizzie coming from this poor family, right? The mom is not at all delightful. She knows that, for all she knows, this Jane girl is trying to get her brother just for his money, doesn't care about him because she doesn't act like she's into him.
Right. And I wanted to point out that she does help Darcy separate them, mm-hmm. but she actually doesn't do it to be malicious. She actually does it because she doesn't think that Jane's fed into him.
Yeah. So, I mean, we know for a fact that Jane really is into Bingley and everything. But at the same time, I can't help but think that, you know, she might be kind of right. If that was me, right, and I was worried about my brother, who is obviously into this girl, and I don't know if this girl's, like, even into my brother or not, I'd be like, I don't know. I do not know if this is a good thing for you.
Right. And she kind of has this whole idea of a perfect family where he marries Georgiana and she marries Darcy and they're paired off perfectly and everything's gorgeous, as opposed to her brother marrying Jane, who she views as beneath them.
And in a way, like you also pointed out, if we liked a guy, haven't we been kind of a dick to a girl that he likes?
Yes.
I know I have.
I think it just happens. I mean, if you both ways, a guy might feel a little bit less inclined to be friendly to a person that he knows you're interested into as well, or whatever, you know, your tendencies may lie, you know?
Mm-hmm. I mean, and, I have looked at my boyfriend's exes and been like, oh my god, I can't believe you dated her, or like seen an ex's new girlfriend be like, really? You went from me to her? Well, okay, that makes me sound awful. But yeah, I've said that.
But I mean, as much as I like Elizabeth,
mm-hmm.
sometimes she does annoy me with her just like blind belief that she's always right, which ties into that whole prejudice theme, that she constantly believes that no matter what, she's correct. Like, she doesn't really listen. Like, she doesn't really listen to advice. She believes that how she's interpreted something is the only way that it should be interpreted, and she's correct. And she doesn't really give anybody a chance until she feels forced to. And to her credit, right, when she gets the letter from Darcy, she does, at first when she reads it, she doesn't believe it. But over time, you know, it speaks to probably internal Lizzie, who, when she had been interacting with Wickham before, was like, oh my god, get away from Dickham.
No, but I mean, that one of the things that I like about Lizzie, that even though she has flaws, she learns. She might not learn them right away, but she does eventually learn. But I will say this, right? I can see Charlotte eventually becoming friends with Caroline. Like, not best friends, but I can see them actually being polite and civil to each other. I don't really see Lizzie and Caroline ever being anything more than just civil to each other, because Caroline's brother and Darcy are friends. But then I can always see Charlotte getting along with most people.
That's the thing, yeah. I think that Charlotte gets along with everyone. I think that, like we were saying before, she's a realist.
Yeah.
Like, Caroline, I don't know. I mean, who do you feel, let's put it this way. Who do you feel sorrier for, Caroline or Charlotte?
Actually, Caroline, because I know she's going to be miserable, but Charlotte has this, like, inner peace.
Yeah, Charlotte's happy with the hand she's been dealt. She's happy living in that place and having a husband she can manipulate and having freedom and having the autonomy that comes with being a married woman in that time. That is seriously superior to other women, right?
Exactly.
Caroline has nothing. Caroline has lost.
So
question. Mm-hmm. Who do we feel sorrier for? Caroline or Wickham?
I would say Wickham, because you have to live with Lydia, and all you have to do is look at Mrs. Bennet, and you will know your future.
Yep.
That is one man I know who will be eager for the Napoleonic Wars.
Yeah. And then the killer is that it's alluded to in the novel that Elizabeth sends money to them.
Because she has to take care of her little sister.
Without Darcy knowing, which is always interesting to me because, you know, money is obviously always a huge topic for fighting in relationships, particularly, you know, in marriage, you know, how money is being spent. And I always think about that and I'm like, damn, that is a future blowout waiting to happen.
You know, but I think in the end, Darcy's not really going to be that mad.
Yeah, probably not. Because, I mean, he did go, he probably would have had to expect it. Probably expects it.
Okay, so I have another question.
Oh, go ahead. And then I have a question for you.
How come we really don't think about these characters as much as we do with Lizzie? I mean, I love Lizzie, like I said, right? But there's so much to these characters. You know, their motivations, their insights. I could totally see a whole side story just on these characters.
Well, I think that there is something inherently more interesting about villains or about the underdogs or about the characters who are just not immediately your main character. Elizabeth has a lot of interesting Our thing is surprising about her. We're not surprised, really,
mm-hmm.
by anything she does. We're not surprised by her being flattered and attracted to Wickham. We're not surprised when she defends Jane. We're not surprised when she hates Darcy. We're not surprised when she disses him. We're not surprised even when she eventually falls in love with him. The other characters behave in ways that are not typical. and they don't make typical decisions, and so it makes us wonder, well, what the fuck happened to them?
Yeah, I was expecting Georgiana to be like Caroline.
Georgiana is boring.
Really? You think so?
Yeah, there's not... I don't ascribe anything else to her. I think that she's a plot device. Like, Lydia is a plot device.
I think there would be a more interesting story if we find out that Georgiana was actually attracted to Wickham and had orchestrated her own elopement, and that, you know, she was...
I think she was attracted to him.
Yeah, but, like, I know that you want me. And, like, her thing, you know, her thing is, my brother didn't rescue me. He ruined my chance at happiness because I love him.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, in the novel, she accepts it, right? Like, she doesn't really think twice about it. She's kind of like, Fitzwilliam knows what he's doing.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's something, I don't know, that's probably, like, fan fiction there.
So then let me ask you this.
All right.
Out of all the men that we've been introduced to, Fitzwilliam Darcy,
yes.
Charles Bingley, Collins, Wickham, who would you want to end up with?
Don't laugh. Promise, don't laugh.
I will.
Colonel Fitzwilliam Darcy, the Darcy cousin that Lizzie talks to.
Oh my god, I forgot to bring him up.
That's the guy for me.
He honestly, no joke, sounds like the funniest, most interesting person to talk to, doesn't he?
Yes.
He's so greedy. He's in a great mood. He makes fun of Darcy with Elizabeth. And he's his cousin. They're like best friends. They're practically brothers.
Yes. But he, like...
They're both Georgiana's guardians.
He is sarcastic, and he mocks Darcy, but not in a dickish way that Wickham does.
Right. I'm so glad you brought it up. I love that whole dynamic of when she meets him, and he's like, I've heard so much about you, I can't wait to hear you play the pianoforte, blah, 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 and she's kind of just like,
what? How do you know me?
Because then you realize that Darcy's been talking to him about her. And she's kind of just like, what the fuck is this? And then they start talking, and then there's actually this whole interesting societal commentary going on in the book, because she's attracted to him too, and he kind of seems attracted to her as well, and they talk, and they're really interested in each other. And then in the course of one conversation, he kind of hints to her, this can't go any further because I'm poor and I need to marry a wealthy woman.
Yes.
And also very interesting.
And I really like that how, you know, he's really upfront about his situation and how he's just like, you know, in another world, he and Charlotte Lucas would be like so perfect for each other.
I was just about to say that to you. Do you think that they would have been a good match? I think that he would have been a really good match with Lizzie.
For Lizzie, and also like, for like, Charlotte.
Totally Charlotte. I'm totally thinking about that. But I'm just thinking, if he'd had his choice, I think he would have chosen Elizabeth.
Yeah.
And I feel like this goes against the beating of my heart to say that, because I'm all about Elizabeth and Darcy. But I think they would have been, like, they're very funny together.
Oh, yeah, they're hilarious together.
They click immediately.
They're hilarious together.
But he would have been good with Charlotte because they're both very... But I do think he probably would have been a really excellent match with Elizabeth. So that's very interesting to me. And I do think it's always interesting in the novel where he's kind of like, and like how awkward that is, because I always feel very awkward. And that scene where he's kind of like, is telling her in so many words, this isn't going anywhere.
Do not fall in love with me. I know I'm so hot, but you can't. We can't make anything together.
Something I forgot to mention before is, you know, our biggest conflict of the novel goes all the way back to that first ball, right?
Uh-huh.
Where he says, he's not handsome enough to tempt me.
Uh-huh.
And for all these years, I have to admit that I never really thought very deeply into Darcy's thoughts or motivations or the statement that he made. I just thought, okay, that's a pompous dick, right?
Yeah.
But I was reading, you know, for research for this, an article, and it basically says, hey, like, think about it. He's freshly off of saving his sister's virtue from his good friend Wickham.
Yeah.
He's just come off of that when he arrives at that ball.
Like, yes.
He literally just saved his sister from that.
Uh-huh.
And now he's with Bingley at a country ball that's beneath him, that he doesn't want to be at. He doesn't feel like being social. He's not a very social person in general, but he really doesn't want to be. He probably just wants to go home and go to bed.
Mm-hmm.
After all of the things he had to do to make sure that Georgiana was okay.
Hang out with his cousin, Fitzwilliam. I don't know, in my opinion, I think he just wants to be at Pemberley, hang out with his sister, hang out with his cousin, Fitzwilliam, who also knows what happened.
He's not even a fucking ball. And then all these people are like, oh, dance with this country girl. And that's probably his biggest nightmare, because now he just, you know, narrowly avoided an unwanted marriage for his sister, right? And he's probably thinking the same thing for himself. And I was reading it, and being shy, which he is, I thought that was an awesome explanation as to why he was so not into it. Like, and especially nasty. And I think that makes sense. I thought that was interesting. So my question to you is, you're Lizzie, okay?
Okay.
Do you forgive him for saying that?
I think she already did.
I'm asking you. You would.
I think I would, especially after meeting Colonel Fitzwilliam, right?
The first time he meets you, you hear him talking about his friend. Let's do this in modern lingo. Are you ready?
Okay.
First time you see him, you're at a party. You're like, kind of attractive. I heard that he has this, like, awesome apartment.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I heard he has this great job. It's pretty cool.
Well, okay, and, you know, can we make it for California that, you know, he has a beachfront Spanish-style colonial with panoramic windows and a wraparound veranda?
All of that. And then so then you're kind of like, you kind of want to talk to him, and your friend tries to kind of get you in a conversation about, I don't know, something Californian that I don't know. You know, you make a really awesome comment, or at least you think so, and he's just kind of like, but it doesn't go anywhere, and you're like, all right, fine. And then maybe a couple minutes later, you overhear him talking to your friend, and your friend's like, listen, why aren't you talking to Rainey? You guys would really hit it off. She said some really fun things back there. And he was like, Rainey? Wow, I'd rather drop dead than go on even a date with her.
Die, motherfucker, die!
I would have to be drunk before I would even consider swiping right on Tinder, let alone actually having a conversation with her. So, Rainey, would you forgive him?
I hope he gets a raging case of herpes from buying used underwear.
So you wouldn't forgive him?
My feelings would be very hurt, but if he tells me why and apologizes and, like, I get to know him better, and I'm like, hey, so why were you such a dick the first time we met? And he's like, yeah, I stopped my sister from being sold into, you know, I don't know, what's the modern day equivalent, sexual slavery. I'd be like, oh, that just finished, and that's why you were here? I'd be like, motherfucker, why were you at a party in the first place? How codependent is your friend? Oh, no, but Bingley didn't know, right?
No, he didn't know.
Yeah.
He didn't.
Was just him and Fitzwilliam.
No, right. And I think also it was Darcy's intention to marry her off to Bingley eventually as well, which was also, you know, plays into his whole dislike of the whole Jane angle. But I don't know if it were me. I'm a very sensitive person.
Yeah.
I remember things that people say, and I just, like, I think I obviously would get over it because they're I think that they're a very good compliment to each other, but damn, I just think about that. I just think about, like, how brilliant it was that Austen wrote it the way that she did, because even in 2017, there are dances right now with bleachers that people can hide under and overhear conversations. And this is a scene that could just be reworded a little bit and be as relevant today.
Oh, yeah, definitely. You know, I could imagine, you know, he's an attractive guy, and of course Lizzie would be intrigued by him, and just hearing somebody, even if you don't like them, hearing that they don't like you and they think that, you know, they're beneath you, that fucking hurts. That fucking hurts, you know?
To her credit, mm-hmm. She's very hurt by it, but then she laughs it off.
Yeah.
I'm like, it's the basis for her dislike of him. But she lets it go.
Yeah, which proves that Lizzie is a much better person than me.
I mean, listen, every night I'd be like, Darcy, I probably have a voodoo doll of him or something like that. Like, I'd probably be weeping every night because that is not handsome enough to tempt me. Like, holy shit, like, I can't even dream up an adequate modern phrase that equates to that. She's not handsome enough to tempt me, you know? I mean, like, and also, we're keeping in mind that this was you're expected to dance. Like, it was just a social requirement.
Yeah, it's like making small talk these days.
Right. Exactly. Like, that's how they communicated with one another. They went on, they took a dance, and the dances would last literally half an hour. If you were dancing for half an hour or more. So, the idea that he wasn't even participating in that, let alone didn't even think she was worth, just for propriety's sake, to dance with.
Exactly.
You know.
Damn, Darcy, why you gotta be so mean, yo?
So at the end of the day, mm-hmm. What do you think about Darcy? Do you think that he's a worthy hero?
I love him. I'm still absolutely fascinated by him. But I still have to say my favorite character, the guy that I would see myself with, would be Colonel Fitzwilliam Darcy, even though he and I are both poor.
So while I agree with you,
mm-hmm.
At the same time, I think we could argue that he's not quite a fire starter, right? He could theoretically go out and marry someone he wanted to, right?
Uh-huh.
And somehow make it work, right?
Yeah.
But he is accustomed to a life of wealth and excess and respectability on all that jazz. Mm-hmm. And he wants to marry into that to be secure. So to a certain extent, is he admirable in that regard?
I think that
he could theoretically go fuck it and marry Elizabeth if he wanted.
Yeah, but then he wouldn't be able to provide for her or for her family either. I think he is like Charlotte Lucas, you know? He's like, hey, I could marry for love and say fuck it and all that, but where would that bring us, you know? You have a family. He might have a family.
He doesn't really. So let's leave family out of it. Let's talk about like the actual, you know, the relationship. If he loved her enough.
Mm-hmm. Well, see, that's the thing. He was attracted to her. He didn't love her.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know. Darcy is.
Hey, let's put it this way. I think I'm interesting enough that I could make Colonel Fitzwilliam change his mind.
Ooh, listen to you, girl.
Yeah, man.
Damn, that's some confidence.
I have my Friday night underwear on.
Holy shit. You are set.
Beware, boys.
I'm happy we got to talk about this. I feel like, I'm a little out of it tonight, so I didn't get to fully be as exuberant as I wanted to about all this, but I do love this book. I love this book because it's not, and I think you've shown this, I feel like you and I right now, in however long we've been talking, if we were to do percentages, I feel like we probably talked about the love aspect between Elizabeth and Darcy probably 20 to 25% of this conversation.
Probably. Your math sounds right.
The rest of it has been about the other characters and about deeper issues like, you know, marrying for love versus marrying for necessity, all, and then, and class and station and what goes into being a respectable member of society at that time. And I think that speaks to how good of an author she was. It wasn't just a blah, like, love story. She can just have, it was something that had a lot to offer.
And I think that's why I get so mad whenever people just refer to her as, like, oh, that romance novelist. Because, number one, romance novels are awesome. I don't know why people hate them. But number two, even if you chuck out the entire love story, right? You have something there.
I gotta preach.
So, next up, what are we going to talk about?
So, we're going to talk about Jane Austen a little bit more in detail, and then we're going to talk in general as well about her other works, comparing and contrasting her characters, her use of characters, and maybe even how her work developed from the beginning into the end.
So, planning out for future podcasts. When are we going to talk about Diamond Girl?
So maybe we should do Jane, this next one, as soon as possible. I feel like we have a lot of material. We could just go for it. I feel like a lot of it is going to be shitting on Mansfield Park. And some disability for me as well, because I don't really care for that either.
Boo! Colonel Brandon is my love.
But, like, I can't. This is the thing. I can't appreciate it because it's not fully reciprocated.
But again, I get it.
Like, it's wasted to me. So yeah, we're going to talk about that, all those things that annoy us about that, and the interesting patterns we find, all that stuff. So we'll do that, you know, ASAP. And then I would really love to go into Diamond Girl, and I encourage everyone to either read it or watch it. It's on YouTube. It's freaking hilarious.
Nice. I love that movie so much.
I'm being a Diamond Girl right now. Give me life. You're Diamond Girl.
I love that movie so much, and it is so awful.
Like, why? But this is the thing. Why do we love it so much?
Why do I think it's so much more rewatchable than A Change of Place, which is so much more the superior movie?
Did you read the book?
What, Diamond Girl?
Yeah.
They're completely different.
It is literally a different story. The book was 80s. She wears glasses. Like, oh my God. Couldn't be more different, which adds to the hilariousness of it. But actually,
they're not even brothers; they're cousins. All right. Well, thank you everyone for listening. Again, she's Rita. I'm Rainey. We are the Underbelly, and please tune in while we dissect Jane Austen and try to figure out how much of herself she put into her books. How disappointed would you be if you turn out her favorite character was Fanny?
Look, I think I'd be so mad. I think her favorite character was Emma. She loved Emma. There's a quote where she said something like, she believes that there was never a more beautiful creature ever created, or something like that, which I'll find and quote directly. But I think that she loved Emma the most.
And what if you find out you remember it wrong and she said it was Fanny?
Then I'll quit this podcast.
You are dead to me, Jane Austen. Dead.
Dead to me. I'll never pick up another Jane Austen book. Midnight, kind of time, where are you? You said you